kind thanks go to Surfshark VPN for sponsoring today's episode. SpaceX Starship updates and Crew Dragon mission progress update. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. It's hard to wrap your head around the speed at which SpaceX is developing their number one priority in Boca Chica, Texas. The Starship program is steaming ahead quite literally, with active testing almost every other day. Monday was one of those days again. SpaceX workers brought the latest prototype, a test tank as we've seen them a few times before, to the launch site. They connected it to the fuel farm and strapped it down. The pad got cleared, the road closed, and everything was set for yet another test run. Main objective this time, testing new material for weaknesses. Serial number 7 is partly made of 304L stainless steel. I talked about the new alloy a few times now. For those who missed it, 304L in a nutshell means better strength at cryo temperatures, and due to its extremely low amount of carbon, 0.03% on average, it's easy to weld and form, and it's extremely resistant to corrosion as well. It didn't take the Boca Chica crew long to prepare for the test, and shortly after, the valves were opened and cryogenic liquid nitrogen was pushed into the tank. Liquid nitrogen is used in these kinds of tests for one main reason. It's inert, meaning it's not flammable and will not cause an explosion if the pressure maximum of a test tank is reached and a rupture occurs. And so, the suffering of serial number 7 began. SpaceX tortured the tough little tank for a solid 5 hours. I watched it live with an awesome crowd on Lewis's stream. Most of you will know him as Lab Padre, though. For all who were there watching it together with me, thanks for making it a very enjoyable evening activity. Large amounts of frost formed on the tank, so much that occasionally large chunks would fall off. Starship serial number 7 did not give up, though. While the tests were going on, Elon tweeted that there were a few known weak spots on this test tank, probably capable of more pressure. So even before starting this test, SpaceX already knew of a few weak spots. Another indicator for SpaceX taking the fast route wherever they can while testing. Why wait for an improved test candidate? Let's put serial number 7 through its paces and see where it gets. As Elon Musk said, the second test tank was to follow shortly anyway and has addressed the weak points. Musk also confirmed that Monday's test of serial number 7 was planned as a test to destruction, meaning that workers would not turn off the liquid nitrogen flow at a certain pressure level, but instead let it flow until the tank bursts. This is done to find the upper limits of a construction and the reason why they strapped serial number 7 down to the test jig. And let me tell you, this test tank was tough. The ice crust got thicker and the evening later for me here in Germany. Finally, past 11 PM my time, serial number 7 gave in. And as every single time we have such an event, it was as unpredictable as it could have possibly been again. No implosion or explosion. No shockwave. Instead, serial number 7 decided to go in a very mannerly way. A roughly 30 to 50 centimeter wide rupture on top of the upper dome led to an almost controlled pressure loss and ended the test. 7.6 bar, as Elon Musk tweeted shortly after the test had ended. That's about average for a test tank. It's more than flight pressure, which would be 6 bar, and less than crewed spaceflight safety margin, which would be 8.5. Surprisingly, SpaceX opened Highway 4 quickly after the test was finished. This gave local photographers like Boca Chica Gal or Andrew Goach the opportunity to get up close with serial number 7 while it was still iced up and venting. This gave us some very unique videos and shots well worth watching. You can see the thick ice crust on the stainless steel outer hull and the rupture just above one of the holding hinges on the top dome. Thank you very much, Mary and Andrew, for taking these. You rock! With the next test tank already in production and a predicted 20 Starships produced only this year, SpaceX is showing the world that developing a rocket can be a crazy fast and very exciting experience. It's hard to imagine what the next few months will bring, but it's safe to say that we're in for a treat this year. At the construction site, Starship serial number 6 has received some more love. The tank stack has been lifted and stacked on top of the finished engine section. This leaves us with the fairing skirt and the nose cone. Since serial number 6 has all the needed mounting points, we could soon see fins being attached to the prototype. This would be the first time since Mark 1 last year that we see a full external build of a Starship prototype. Serial number 5 seems to be largely done now as well, with complex plumbing installed on the tank stack. What you can see here is the famous Tesla motor setup for hydraulics. Besides the batteries, this is another Tesla part on the Starship prototypes. Either for engine gimbal, leg movement, turbopump spin starts, or later on fin actuation, the Tesla motors are a perfect in-house solution combining Tesla's know-how with SpaceX's Starship project. It will be interesting to see if SpaceX will ever consider utilizing Tesla for more than just lent parts. Will there ever be a specialized electric motor for Starships built by Tesla? The current solution is to just take the motor from the Tesla Model S. As explained by Elon Musk in December of 2019, Starship uses the Plaid motor. It's the high-powered version of the Model S drivetrain. Basically, a Tesla motor on steroids to be released in a future version of Model S and the new Roadster, where three of them will make the cars even faster. And the strongest available variant is needed too. The rear flaps, being a large movable part, need a lot of force to be moved against the wind while the Starship falls through the sky. Musk spoke of around 1.5 megawatts of power for each flap. Since these aerodynamic surfaces will have to be moved rapidly to keep the trajectory on course while doing the skydive maneuver. And if you want to get more info about SpaceX's Starship development, details about what exactly they're doing, and lots of other interesting insights into Blue Origin, NASA, Rocket Lab, and many other launch providers and their rockets, I suggest you check out my quickly growing library of episodes. While you're at it, do not forget to hit the like button wherever you see it, and please do subscribe if you have not done so yet. This shows the YouTube algorithm that you actually appreciate my work, and in return enables me to make more content for you. Thank you! SpaceX Boca Chica is busy as always, and the prototypes tested are more and more advanced. The new 304L stainless steel is being implemented right now, while the in-house produced alloy to be used later this year is already getting ready. Sometimes it seems like SpaceX's progress is so fast they are overtaking their own progress. Crew Dragon mission progress update. May 30s, 17 days, and it seems like yesterday that we saw Doug and Bob ride the Dragon towards the International Space Station. Since I've not done anything on the topic since then, I think it's about time to do a progress update on what the two Starmen have achieved since liftoff. Only a few hours after launch, right after the astronauts had some time for themselves in the capsule, they started one of the most critical elements of this test flight. They tested manual capsule control in real conditions. And SpaceX gave us some absolutely stunning pictures of the event. Anyone who's tried SpaceX's recently released little docking simulator knows by now that it's very close to reality. No flight stick, almost no physical buttons or switches, everything is controlled via the large touchscreens, and frankly, it seemed to work very well. The manual flight test was a full success.
And SpaceX Dragon 4.042, we see ourselves down through step 2.6. We'll have some comments on the thermal camera blanking out during the maneuver, which was different from training. But other than that, we think we're ready to move on to section 3.
After that came a guided tour, live from the capsule in space.
Well, everyone, welcome aboard Dragon. My name is Doug. Next to me is Bob. You probably know him. We're so glad to be with you this evening and welcome you on board Dragon.
Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome aboard Endeavour, the SpaceX vehicle headed to the International Space Station.
SpaceX and NASA did a wonderful job of working together with the two astronauts to show us on Earth what they are working with in orbit. Detailed explanations of the software. What can be displayed on the screens and how does a crew interact with the capsule? How to activate the forward view with navigation controls? The button panel below the screens got some explanation too. On the right side of the emergency abort lever are screen controls. Further on the right, we have contingency controls for emergency situations. To the left, we have chute deployment and other operations needed for re-entry. So there are a few physical buttons to ensure that everything critical is redundant. The primary interfaces, though, are the three displays. What became clear too is how spacious a Crew Dragon is on the inside. Everyone who's seen a Soyuz capsule from the inside at launch knows how cramped up astronauts are riding on the Russian spacecraft. On Crew Dragon though, Bob Behnken was able to just float around inside the capsule, take a look out the two windows and explain a bit more about the general interior. They showed their little stowaway, a little stuffed dinosaur sent up to space by one of Bob Behnken's children. Good choice. One day later, on May 31st, the journey to the ISS had its finale with a fully automated docking procedure. Everything worked as planned. Crew Dragon's onboard guidance systems were able to go all the way up to a soft capture and docking was a full success. After docking came the big moment everyone at NASA and SpaceX was waiting for so long. The hatch was opened and the two starmen boarded the ISS. And I have to agree with Jim Bridenstine, who spoke to the ISS crew live after boarding. The whole world saw this mission and we are so proud of everything you have done for the US and in fact to inspire the world. As a little fun fact, in this view of the ISS you might notice a flag attached to the ISS inner hatch. This flag was brought up to the ISS by the shuttle crew of STS-135. It was the last crew to leave Earth towards the ISS from US soil in 2011. Back then, Doug Hurley brought the flag up as a task for the next US crew launched from US soil to bring it back down again with them. This honor now falls to Bob and Doug and ends the long drought of human spaceflight from the United States. Now comes the actual mission. Behnken and Hurley will live and work on board the ISS for 2 to 3 months and then re-enter with their capsule, splash down in the Atlantic Ocean and end the demo mission too. Of course, I am already planning a live stream for this event. Together with TJ from I Need More Space and Marcus House, we will try to keep the re-entry stream as interesting as our lineup for the launch. But how do we compete with Amy Shearer Title, Emily Calandrelli and Scott Parasinski, a 5-time shuttle astronaut? How about Apollo astronauts? Rusty Schweikert, Apollo 9 and hopefully Jim Lovell, Gemini 7 and 12, Apollo 8 and 13 and Michael Collins, Gemini 10 and Apollo 11 will join us for a comparison between the Apollo capsule era and the modern Crew Dragon. There's of course no firm date yet, but I'll as always keep you informed. When looking at the broadcasts from the capsule and from the ISS, it all looks so easy, right? Especially when looking at missions like Apollo 13, we all get a serious reminder though that space is a dangerous and hostile environment. Only our will to constantly innovate and our ingenuity to find solutions for countless amounts of problems enable us to make it seem like a ride in the park. Safety and security are not only important when it comes to space exploration. Even in our daily life, we constantly encounter situations when these aspects become key. Only when safety fails and security is broken, we become aware of the importance. Today's sponsor might help you to never reach that point. Data and identity theft, traceability, intrusive advertising, and geo-blocking. Those are realities almost everyone has been confronted with when moving about in the digital world. And most of the time, we're not even aware of the danger. Surfshark VPN encrypts your data with an AES 256-bit standard and turns you into a harder target for attackers to get you, and if you're a tough target, they'll go somewhere else. Or do you want a bigger library on your favorite streaming services like Netflix or Disney Plus? Surfshark can help you there too, by removing the so-called geo-block from your account. All streaming services have different catalogs in different countries. What if you could watch them all? Just activate your VPN, change your virtual location, refresh the page, and you're safe for at least another 6 months of being logged in. I use Surfshark every day. It automatically starts up whenever I start my PC, and whenever I need it, I activate it with just one click. Use my code to get 85% off plus 3 extra months for free, and at the same time, support What About It. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there is no risk. Surf with your own rules, links in the description. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It. Did you watch the serial number 7 testing live, and what are your expectations for Boca Chica in 2020? As always, tell me in the comments. Episode 98. Two more and we'll have the big 100. 100 times of Let's Dive Right In and 100 times your support for the next episode. This one is for all the YouTube members and patrons who decided to go the whole nine yards and support the channel with ideas, funding and research. Thank you for making What About It what it is and for accompanying me on the way. Without these people, What About It wouldn't be the same, so show your love for them in the comments and maybe even consider becoming one yourself. And as always, there are new members on the team. Everyone, please give a warm welcome to Huber Zepp, Alex Mogavero, Niels NB, Jonathan Rhodes, Roadkill, Antonio Cesar Hansen Monte Pegado, and many others. You rock! Thank you for watching this episode of What About It. If you enjoyed the content, make sure to give it a like and consider a subscription. It's a version of support that doesn't cost a penny. Make sure to check out my merch store. It's full of shirts, hoodies, and other shiny things in excellent quality at a low price, made by space nerds for other space nerds. It all helps me to give you the latest and greatest about space and science. I hope to see you on the next episode. Until then, have a great time. My name is Slim Shady. And as unpredictable to reality. To leave Earth from US oil. Yeah, there's a construction site right next to the house. Tell me in the comments.